Okay, welcome to EC695H. Yeah, please turn off. Yeah, that will work. So this course is entitled Optimization Theory. Actually, precisely speaking, it's a kind of introduction to optimization. Probably you have seen some other departments offering undergraduate level courses similarly named, like Introduction to Optimization in Industrial Engineering and other departments. Those courses are not prerequisites. Okay, this course does not assume any prior exposure to optimization. So as far as you graduated undergraduate school, then it's okay. I assume that your undergraduate school taught you multivariate calculus and linear algebra. Okay, these two are undergraduate level prerequisites, and there is no other prerequisite. Okay, let's see the course homepage with our syllabus. Okay, 정훈 씨,
네.
앞으로 항상 띄워놓으세요.
네.
So this is my lab homepage, and if you click this teaching, you will find here Introduction to Optimization. The course title is temporarily 695H, but I'm planning to make it a regular course with number 589. That's why it has 589, but definitely the course is currently 645H. Okay, so if you click this one, then you will see the syllabus, and here goes announcements, and here goes schedule and downloads. Especially in schedule and downloads, you can find these lecture notes. Okay, I will shortly cover. So on every Monday and Wednesday, 2 p.m., we will have a meeting. Originally, I guessed there is less than 6 students, so I can have the class meeting in my office as I did some with some other courses, but it seems that we are already a kind of full house, so let's have our meeting here. Probably we have to change this to 104, right? Yeah, Jungwon, please change this one. Okay, and you know who I am, and here was our TA Jungwon Choi. Of course, he had taken the previous course. This course is offered now the second time, probably 2 years ago, 1 year and a half. Yeah, exactly 2 years ago, Professor Soo-Hee Han taught this course with the same textbook and same note, actually. And this is the second time. And Jung-hoon will be responsible for giving you homework that in every 2 weeks. He will grade, and also he will be the contact point for this course. You can contact him or me, but I prefer you contact TA first. The textbook is Edwin Chong and Stanislaw Jack's textbook. This is a kind of well-adapted textbook in the US as an introductory optimization in the kind of middle of undergraduate and graduate level. Okay, when I was taught this course by the first author at Purdue University, this book was kind of first edition. Now it's fourth edition. And you can either buy third edition used book as a used book, or you can buy fourth edition. There is no much difference. Most importantly, the lecture note I use is based on the third edition. So buying third edition may be almost perfectly okay, except when the homework problems are assigned. Okay? I will ask the TA whenever he gives you the homework from the textbook, if the problem number is different in the third and fourth edition, he will mark like problem 4 in chapter 7, formerly problem 2 in third edition, something like that. So it will be okay. Okay, but do not use second edition or fourth edition. The number of problems are totally different. OK, Okay, so I ask you to buy this book. Okay, this book is a kind of very good, how to say, reference as well as a textbook. So if you are an engineering student, probably you have to have a set of optimization textbooks. Probably this will be the first one. The second one, which I suggest, is this famous book. Okay, Stephen Boyd is a professor of electrical engineering and at the same time mathematics at Stanford University. And he kind of 10 years ago probably wrote this book based on his lecture at Stanford University. At that time, he was kind of investigated this theory of convex optimization very deeply, and there was quite interesting series of research papers in Stanford communications area. At that time, the theory of convex optimization was not that widely known to the researchers, but he was the kind of first man who seriously taught this one. And graduate student at that time could generate very, very interesting research results just after taking this course. So what I suggest is this. If you search for convex optimization at YouTube, actually, his convex optimization lectures are available. Okay. The problem is that probably at this level of your knowledge on optimization, you cannot take that video lectures. So my goal, one of the goals from this course is that you are prepared to self-study this one. Okay. Long ago, I offered this course as a regular course, but actually that was not a regular course. There was only two students of my group, and I asked them to view the videos from YouTube, and what I did was just giving them homework regularly, okay, and they studied. Okay. The book is a little bit challenging, very thick actually. If you print it, then this thick. Okay. And also, you can easily see that from the YouTube that this course actually is convex optimization 1 and 2. Okay. So, in order to have the kind of most up-to-date knowledge, probably you have to study very, very hard. But without having introductory knowledge, level of knowledge in optimization, it would be almost impossible for you to just self-study convex optimization. So I kind of decided to offer this introductory optimization course to you so that I can bridge your huge gap between at this current status and this level. Okay? So what I strongly suggest is that after taking this course, you self-study this one. Okay? This theory is very, very interesting, not just for our knowledge, but for its practical implication. Okay? Currently, many problems are kind of solved by using this convex optimization theory. Okay. Sometimes the problem itself is not convex, but kind of convexify and then solve. Convex optimization has very interesting property that the numerical optimization really works. Okay. So even though you cannot find a closed form optimal solution, numerical solutions can be always found at your arbitrary, satisfactory error performance. Anyway, I will talk about that later. Course objectives are, first, basic concepts you learn. Okay. Second, you formulate some problems so that you can solve, and you find the solutions. Okay. And you may say that, well, the second one, is that important? Yes, actually. As a graduate student, your goal is not to find the solution of a problem. You find a good problem to solve, and of course, find the solution. Okay? So In many cases, for example, sequence optimization or waveform design, the problem is formulated as an optimization problem. If you formulate the problem well, you can find the solution. If problem is poorly formulated, sometimes you cannot solve because of your poor formulation. Okay? So this is very, very important. However, my experience now, how many years ago? 20 years ago as a graduate student. Is it 20 or 30? 20. At your level. This course was quite challenging, actually. There were many kind of classes of optimization problems, so I have to memorize many things, and also I have to prove many things. Some departments offer optimization theory just to give you cookbook knowledge. Okay, so this type of problem is solved in this way. You use some tool. This type of problem can be solved that way, so you use that tool. This textbook is not designed in that way. Okay, this is rather how to say that as an engineer, you yourself. It's like this book, this course is designed, this textbook is designed to help you formulate the problem and solve your solution. Sometimes in a closed form or sometimes not. Anyway, so this is the outline. The textbook itself is divided into four. First is the mathematical review. So we will review some linear algebra material and some multivariate calculus material. And the second part is unconstrained optimization. I will talk about this. And then we have constrained optimization problem. Among constrained optimization problems, the simplest one is the linear programming or linear optimization. Probably some of you who took undergraduate level optimization theory course from the industrial engineering, most of your time, I believe, was spent in linear programming. So probably this may give you some relief during this intense course. And actually, the most important part is this one, nonlinear optimization. In general, nonlinear optimization does not have a closed form solution. So your solution must be searched numerically. But interestingly, some classes, very important classes of problems, have closed form or semi-closed form or closed algorithmic description of the solution. Now that's very, very interesting. And convex optimization, you will study, you will study after taking this course, is one of them. Okay, very, very interesting. Okay, prerequisites, as I already told you, are undergraduate calculus and linear algebra. You may not like this course requirement. There will be three exams. The reason is that if I just give you one midterm and final, probably most of you will be apparently happy, but in final, probably very, very unhappy. So I will kind of kick your hips a lot of time by giving you midterms. Okay, we will decide the dates later. As it shows, the midterms will be taken in the afternoon, and probably for more than for 3 hours, something like that. You are allowed to bring crib sheets, so it will be okay. A4 size crib sheet, both sides you can use. Okay. So these are the syllabus related things. And you will read grading policies and other things. Any questions about syllabus? Okay, you can ask after the meeting. Now let's take a look at some lecture notes. Okay, these are copyrighted materials. I got the permission from the Professor Chong actually 7 years ago. he still permits my use of this one. Anyway, if you find Professor Sui Han's material, he got the lecture note from the same professor in 2009 version. Okay, this is 2007 version, but I don't believe there are many differences. Okay, so if you click these links, then you can download. And they are all password protected. For example, if you right click and open, then the password is asked. Usually, passwords are very easy. As you see, this is chapter 00, and you type in 0, Z-E-R-O, then it opens, okay? So there are actually two chapter 0 materials. And this is the syllabus of Professor Chong's course offered in 2007. Okay. Almost the same. The objectives are to provide you the introduction to optimization theory and method applications in control and communications, actually. And analysis, algorithm development, something like that. And textbook is, in this case, second edition. Okay. Anyway, it's currently fourth edition is available. Almost the same structure, two midterms and final. Oh, by the way, some of the problems in the textbook ask you to do some MATLAB programming. I haven't yet decided I will select some such problems for your homework or not. Okay, I haven't yet decided. Maybe I will give you, or maybe not. Okay. So, but I can say that it's highly likely that you will see some MATLAB homework problems. Okay, not that many. So, some knowledge on MATLAB may be necessary. Okay. By the way, Professor Chong lists related optimization problems are like optimal control. This is really for control area students. And parameter estimation is actually will be taught next semester. Okay. Usually, we communications area offer EECE 645 statistical signal processing or alias estimation and detection theory, which are all about parameter estimation. And also in control area, Professor Pugyan Park also offers the graduate level course entitled Estimation Theory, which is all about Kalman filtering and Wiener filtering. Okay. So this course is kind of provides fundamentals related to this parameter estimation, because parameter estimation problems are all actually optimization problems. And optimal design, this may be a sequence design or waveform design. And one of the chapters of this book is about neural network. These days, you have heard a lot about the convolutional neural network or recursive neural network. And this book has one chapter dedicated to convolutional neural network, because the second author's major is artificial intelligence, Professor Jacks. He's still at Purdue University. I will not cover that chapter, okay? Professor Han, when he taught 2 years ago, he covered that, but I will not. Okay. So do not expect too much. Okay, I will not talk about AlphaGo and other things. And optimal pricing is related to financial engineering or investment. They are all doing optimizations. Okay. So in the early stage of Korean financial engineering, many practitioners were from electrical engineering, because they were taught optimization, they were taught random processes. And you will see that even at post-tech, some industrial engineering students are taught these two, but most of them are not. But in electrical engineering, we have been enforcing the probability theory as a mandatory from the beginning. Okay, especially we emphasize random processes. So you will find some post-tech graduates who is in the financial sector and from other universities, from the same department. So optimal pricing is also related to optimization. Investment planning also related. So this knowledge on optimization is actually very, very practical for your life, because anyway, you have to do some financial planning. And also will be very important for your career as an engineer. Anyway, engineering is all about optimization. Okay? You want to find a very good design, and that's what is done in optimization. Okay, now let's take a look at the introductory material. But I will not follow that one. I will briefly review that material, but let me write down something what I believe important. Okay. So this optimization is not a new topic. You have been taught on the optimization from your probably middle school, actually. Let me give you an example. Probably you remember something like this, okay? X and Y are real numbers, especially a non-negative real number. By the way, this R plus, R sup plus means non-negative real. Okay? And if I wrote like this, it's positive real, strictly positive. Okay? Sometimes I may write this way. Okay? And in your middle school or high school, you have been seeing something like this. X is less than or equal to 5, and of course greater than or equal to 0. Y is greater than or equal to 0 and less than 3. And X plus Y is less than 2. Okay? And what you want to do is that you want to maximize this value. Okay? Probably you'll be seeing something similar. Okay? Or you've seen some similar problem in your undergraduate linear programming problem. Okay? So how can you solve? We use kind of graphical approach like this. Okay? So here goes 5.0 and here goes 0.3 and 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, and it seems it's too small. Let me increase a little bit. Okay, let me use 4. Okay, then we have 4. So this is the kind of set of x comma y, right? So among one of these points inside this rectangle, we want to find a pair x comma y that maximizes this value. Well, how can we find? So what we did was like this. So let's set this equal to c, and we change c, the value of c. If c is 0, then you have something like this. Something like this. Okay. And so if you increase C, then you will have parallel lines so you know that, okay, probably the point, is it 1, 3? I guess so, yeah. We'll maximize this value, something like that. Okay? So this was the kind of optimization problem you've seen in your high school or middle school. And this is not the only one. Actually, you've seen other problems like this. Sometimes so-called in Korean, 최대 최소 problem. And probably in your high school, in order to solve such problems, you've used theorems like this. When you have non-negative, in this case, positive real numbers, then the arithmetic mean is always greater than or equal to the geometric mean, and geometric mean is always greater than or equal to the harmonic mean, something like that. So by using the inequalities, you sometimes maximize x times y, sometimes minimize x plus y, given some constraints on x and y. Probably you remember this one. Especially Korean students, probably you remember Suhage Jeongseok will have had given you a lot of problems related to maximization and minimization, which were only solved by through using these inequalities. Another one was so-called Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, or sometimes it's called Schwarz inequality. But they were all related to something like this. You have two vectors or signals. So inner product of them, inner product of two vectors is less than or equal to the magnitude of the first signal and the magnitude of second signal. So probably what you've seen is something like this. Times something like this. So this is nothing but the inner product of A vector and X vector, and this is the norm square, two norm square of A vector and two norm square of X vector, something like that. So by using some inequalities, you solved minimization and maximization problems in your probably first year high school. Okay? And then your focus little bit changed to what? Calculus. So it's like given some function ax squared plus bx plus c, then you wanted to find the so for example given some constraint, okay, you wanted to find value x that minimize this function. Okay, if a is non-zero, then this is a quadratic function. And given the interval, you want to find x that minimize or maximize this value. You've seen something like that. Okay? When the function is quadratic, it's very easy by finding the point of symmetry. But what if we have more than three terms? If we have six terms, seven terms, that's why we learned differentiation. Okay, so for example, when we had something like this with some fifth order polynomial, how could we find the minimizer of this? Minimizer means that that scalar, that real valued x that minimizes this function given some interval. And actually you are taught, right? We differentiate this function and find x that makes first order derivative equal zero, and also we examine the endpoints of our interval and find which x gives us the minimum value of f, something like that. So actually we have been continuously exposed to optimization problems. Even we have never been taught optimization theory. In this course, we are not going to repeat middle school or high school material. Okay, sometimes we need. Okay, sometimes, but we are not going to repeat. We are going to extend what we learned already, and also we will add some new stuff. Okay. for example. So before, the problem was like this, but what if you have something like that? Suppose you have a function of x and y. Okay. As you see that this is a function of two real values, x and y. And you may say that, what the hell is this? But anyway, you will see. Okay. And I give you some constraints, like x and y are all non-negative, and some transpose. This is bounded by 5 and 10, blah, blah, blah. And find x, comma y that minimizes this value, something like that. And this is, as you notice, is closely related to this problem. Okay? As you see, we have the second order term, x squared, and also y squared and x times y here. And this here goes first order term. This is simply cx plus dy, right? So it's kind of extension, okay? And this is so-called actually a quadratic equation in x and y, okay? This is a quadratic formula in only in x. So this is an extension. And you will see that solving this kind of problem is as easy as solving this problem. Okay? So you will see many similar problems to what you already know. But the kind of dimensionality or length may be increased hugely. Okay? So it's similar to engineering problem. In engineering problem, for example, you want to design a filter of finite length, so-called finite impulse response filter. And suppose you want to design the impulse response. In that case, how many real numbers, for example, you want to find? More than one, right? If filter response has length 100, then what you want to find is length 100 vector. It's not simple, this finding a single scalar, finding length 2 vector or 2 real numbers. Your problem now shifts to find length 100 vector. Now, for example, you want to design a sequence, but that sequence is periodic with period 1023. Okay? In that case, apparently, what you want to find is a sequence of infinite lengths, but due to the periodicity, actually, what you want to find is length 1023 vector. Okay? So, in many engineering problems, what you want to find can be mapped or viewed as a vector. Sometimes real valued, sometimes complex valued. Okay. So in this course, since we cannot cover every possible optimization problems, we restrict our scope. Okay. So in most of the cases, what we want to find is a real valued vector. And you may say that, why? I want to optimize a complex number, complex valued vector. In that case, actually, what you can do is that you take the real part of the vector and complex imaginary part of the vector and augment these two vectors and to have twice as long as the original complex vector. Then you optimize that. Okay. So here goes our scope. So, definitely more than what you learned already in mid school and high school. Okay, so we will more talk about finding a vector, not a scalar. Okay, so do not expect finding scalar. Okay. Of course, there are some problems, but in most of cases, you are asked to find a vector that is best. Okay. Second, we consider some real valued vector. Okay. And be careful, okay, because some optimization problems really requires complex valued vector to be found, because the problem can only be well formulated in terms of complex valued functions. Okay. The problem is that it requires sometimes new technique. Okay. I will not talk about much, but it's like this. Probably in your engineering maths, you are taught how to differentiate some complex argument functions. You remember? Some analytic functions, blah, blah, blah. Okay. They are actually quite different from real valued functions. Okay. In most of cases, we are not handling that. So still, we want to maximize the value of this function f, or minimize this value of function f, okay? Which means that this is a real valued function. Okay? So we restrict this way. Okay? So the typical problem looks like this. Minimize f of x subject to x in some set. Now let's remember our middle school or high school linear programming problem. This is related to what? X is greater than or equal to 0 and less than or equal to 5. Y equals greater than or equal to 0 and less than or equal to 3. X plus y is less than or equal to 4, something like that. Okay, and this f of x is what? X plus 5y. Okay, so we still do something similar to what we have done. Okay, this is called objective function or cost function. Of course, you can either maximize or minimize. But since in many cases we view this function to be optimized, it's a cost function, we want to minimize the cost. Okay? So the convention is minimization of the objective function. Of course, you can formulate the other way by putting a negative sign. So, kind of standard form in optimization has minimization instead of maximization. So this is the problem form, but you are going to see repeatedly in this course. Okay. So remember this. Okay. Sometimes this is called constraint set. Okay. Or a feasible set. Sometimes feasible set or constraint set will be given implicitly, like x and y are non-negative reals. Or sometimes it will be given as an inequalities, okay? Or intersections of some subsets. So vector x must be satisfied, must be a member of some omega 1 and at the same time omega 2 and at the same time the complement of omega 3, something like that. Okay. So there could be many, many, many different types of optimization problems. However, we restrict our problem to simple ones. Because this course is not, as I told you, to provide a kind of cookbook approach to optimization. The most important is that to understand what is an optimization. Okay? So the textbook, the authors of textbook has selected some of important problems, not all. Okay? Then I find that I need to emphasize what other problems are also important in optimization. Okay? Even though you will see this type of problems only this type of problems in this course, but there are many different important optimization problems. Okay. So let's see. First, let's take a look at this one. Okay. So in our course, we find vector, but is it the only one? You may find the matrix, right? Sometimes you are asked to find a matrix that maximizes something or minimizes something. Let me give you an example that is from information theory. Okay. So this is for example, recently, not recently now, 10 years ago, this has become a very important problem in information theory. Okay. It may be confusing at this point. Yeah, something like that. So let's take a look at this problem. First, here R sub XX. Some of you may guess that it looks like a correlation matrix of a random vector X. You're right, okay? So after some formulation in communication problem, people found that they want to find the correlation matrix. They want to need to find the optimal, best correlation matrix for random vector. Since this is a correlation matrix, this is a positive semi-definite always. Okay. By the way, if you do not remember positive semi-definiteness, please read your undergraduate textbook, okay? I believe you know this, or at least if you search Wikipedia and read the material, then you remember these things, okay? So anyway, and also this is the trace of this. Oh, by the way, I didn't mention this. This is called decision variable or optimization parameter. Or such parameter or optimization parameter or argument. Okay, so you want to find vector X, but here you want to find matrix X, R sub XX. Okay. And another one is that this is a logarithmic function, but its argument is slightly different. This DT is the determinant of this matrix. And here, this is, for example, an N by N identity matrix, a square matrix that has all zeros except one in the ones in the diagonal. And here, again, here comes your optimization parameter, the parameter to be found, correlation matrix. And here, H is so-called multi-input, multi-output channels, channel matrix. It's given in some form. This is given. And this is the transpose. Actually, it must be, I guess, Hermitian transpose, because this R sub XX is, in general, a complex-valued Hermitian symmetrical positive semi-definite matrix. And this is constant. Probably, this is the noise variance of your additive white Gaussian noise, something like that. And right now, probably you have no idea how to find this, how to solve this problem. Okay. By the way, if you want to put this problem in this standard form, first, probably you want to change this to minimization. By the way, this minimize, okay, is sometimes abbreviated as min, okay? Okay. But some very picky authors put dot here because he or she want to differentiate minimum from minimize. Okay? So min means minimum. This min dot means minimize. Okay? So if I follow this type of notation, probably there I have to say something like this. Okay? But without having this dot, it still makes sense. It's like, for example, this entire thing may be a number of this logarithmic function when it is maximized, right? Maximum of this one. Okay? So depending on the context, you need dot or not. Okay? Let's see some other thing. Let's go back to our previous problem, quadratic problem. So I want to find, for example, x, y, and I have something like this. And by the way, this s dot t dot is often in some mathematics textbook is the abbreviation of such that, but it is not here. Okay, it's the abbreviation of subject to. Okay, so whenever we talk about constraint set or feasible set, we use this. Okay, subject to. Now, blah blah blah. Very important and in many cases never mentioned technique in vector optimization, which means you want to find an optimal vector that minimize or maximize this objective function, is to simply do line search in two dimensions. It's like this. Okay. The trick is same thing here. In some cases, it's not easy. It's not easy to translate this constraint to this one, but sometimes it's easy. Suppose this, there is no constraint. Then minimization over x, y can be viewed as minimization over x and minimization over y. Okay, so it's like this. Suppose this is your constraint set. Okay, now you want to find some x, y. We don't know the shape of this one, but we can guess it's a kind of quadratic. And what you do is that you convert this problem of finding a length 2 vector into finding length 1 scalars. And what you do is that you fix x, okay, and then find y that minimize this one. So it's like you divide this into strips having almost the same x. Okay, so in each strip you find y that minimize this objective. In that case, if you are asked to put here min, probably you want to put dot here, but no dot here. Okay? Because You want to minimize this value, right? Got it? You have the idea? Okay. So if you put that here, does not make sense, right? Because this must be a value. Must have some value. But if you put that here, how do you minimize some minimize? Okay. You want to minimize the minimum of this one. Got it? Okay. So you have to be careful. Okay. Sometimes this putting that is very tricky and important. Anyway, this is called nested optimization. So you solve this sum problem for every x, and then find x that gives you minimum. For example, here on this strip, this may be the optimal point. For this strip, this, something like this. Okay. And now, for each x, you find y that minimizes this one. And then, for each, now you do search for x that gives you the minimum value. So you compare the value of this function at these points and find. You can do that actually. Especially, for example, you have this off diagonals are zero. In that case, it can easily separate it and solve it. Anyway, so let me go back. Okay. So first, there are many important optimization problems where our decision parameter or variable is not a real valued vector. It's not a complex valued vector. That's easy. It's a matrix. You may say that, wait a minute, if I want to find a scale matrix, I may view it as a collection of column vectors, and then I may stack, and you are right. So in that sense, you still want to find a vector. However, if you learn how to solve this problem, you will immediately see that that approach is not good. Because this constraint actually means what? It's a symmetric matrix, positive semi-definite. This type of constraints cannot be well written in terms of that augmented vector type approach. Okay? So you have to remember that what we are going to learn in this course is not everything. Okay? If we want to find the optimal matrix, it's a different story. But interestingly, very interestingly, your convex optimization course will talk about that. Okay? So convex optimization, not always, but it's very, very powerful. Okay? It works not only for vectors, it works for matrices. Okay? The theory is very, very strong. However, it's in Korean proverb, 기지도 못하면서 날지는 말아야죠. So we are going to crawl first, okay, in this course, and then fly in other courses. Okay, so remember, finding a real valued vector is the major scope of this problem, this course, but it's not all. Okay, it's also very important. Now it has become very important to find a positive semi-definite symmetric matrix, especially in communications. Multiple input, multiple output communications with multiple transmit and receive antennas. That is kind of now standard for 4G and 5G and later 6G. So it becomes important and important. So what else? So we started from scalar, right? Finding a scalar-valued optimal parameter. Now we changed it to vector. Now matrix, what else? Sequence, right? Sometimes we want to find an optimal sequence. Now let's remember, a real valued sequence has countably infinite real valued numbers. Okay? So sometimes our approach like finite number, right? See that? This anyway is a finite length, does not work. Sometimes we have to design a sequence. without period. Okay. And that is related to so-called Markov decision process. If you study control, especially the sequential decision, the part of sequential decision, you will see MDP or Markov decision process. It's something related to you make a decision, you find optimal value right now, or optimal vector right now, and you make an observation, and you make another optimal decision, you make observation, another one, something like that. The simplest form of this type of sequential decision is related to Kalman filtering or Wiener filtering, and especially Kalman filtering. Okay? But after some study, you will find Kalman filtering, probably at the first glance, very, very difficult, but the most easiest one. Okay? There are many, many difficult sequential decision problems. In that case, you design a sequence of vectors in many cases. Okay? So it's like you start from scalar, vector, matrix, and sequence, right? What else? Waveform. Okay? Sometimes we want to find the waveform. Let me give you the most famous example. Okay. So in 16-something-something, probably you remember the Bernoulli family, or Bernoulli family, famous for generating fine mathematicians in 17th century and 18th century. They did a lot of things in statistics and even the fluid mechanics and something. One of the Bernoullis, I do not remember whose exact name, kind of posted a quiz problem on the web page of the mathematicians at that time, like solve this problem. His problem was like this. So given two numbers, this is H and this is L, let me say W. Okay. So the problem is to design a slope. So suppose that slope is this. Okay. Then you put a ball here with no friction. And to this downward direction, you have gravitational field constant. Okay? Similar to what really happens here on the surface of Earth, right? It can be well approximated, but precisely speaking, at this point and that point, gravitational acceleration is a little bit different, but we can model it as constant, right? Now, the question was to design this slope so that this ball reaches here at the minimum time, after minimum time elapsed. And this problem was named as Brachistochrone. Okay. By the way, this word, single word, is originated from Latin root. Chron means time. Probably you remember chronometer, something related to the chron. Chron means time. Okay. And this is the kind of shortest. Okay. So this is shortest time problem. Okay. So the problem was to design the slope. Or you may say that, what? Find the optimal waveform, okay? Optimal function. Let's say this H of W. Okay? W0, H0. So you want to find some H of W, right? That minimize some elapsed time. Elapsed time, okay? Subject to what? H of omega is from 0 to omega W0, and H of W is greater than 0, probably, something like that. Okay? So anybody guess the solution? Definitely, the straight line connecting these two points is not the solution. Okay? if it was a solution problem, he never asked. And I do not know how to derive the solution, but the answer is surprising me, a part of cycloid. Okay. That's well known. I do not know how does it fit, but it's a cycloid. Okay. And of course, the Bernoulli, who posted this problem, posted the problem after he found the solution. But many fine mathematicians at the time spent days and nights to find it, except only one person. It is well known that Isaac Newton, when he saw the problem, he solved in a night by inventing a new field of mathematics called calculus of variations. You know what is calculus in Korean, 미적분학. Okay, this is translated using Chinese character. It's called 변분법. Okay, variation means 변하다. So, okay. Anyway, so if you take the optimal control theory from the control professor, okay, he will talk about this calculus of variation. Variations. But we are not going to cover it either. Okay? So as I repeatedly told you, this course has very strong limitation. Okay? I will not talk about everything. I will talk about only very small section where our decision parameter is a real valued vector, okay? Not a function. Like this Brock-Heisterkron problem. Okay. Now the sequence in sequential decision problem. Okay. We will also not talk about the cases where our the decision parameter is a graph. For example, we don't talk about this. No polynomial case. No fields. So, among possible decision parameters, waveform, fields, we will focus on this one. Got it? Okay. But you will find that in many cases, this is enough. Okay. This is enough. Okay, what else do I need to talk? Okay, another one. So, let me go back. So, I just have talked about this search space. Decision parameter. Okay. What you need to remember? It could be scalar, vector, matrix, sequence, waveform, polynomial, some field, other things, every possible things. But we focus on real valued finite length vectors. Okay. Second. Now. Here, our vector is a member of n-dimensional Euclidean space, but with some constraint, right? But interesting thing is that, so precisely speaking, it's something like this. Okay? The reason why I write in this way is this one. Anyway, X is an n-dimensional vector, but it's not the entire n-dimensional space. We have some constraint. But this omega, the constraint set, now can be divided. Okay? This is what? Now we assume that this is a uncountably infinite set. Okay? Probably you are not familiar, so I talk about this one. So given a set, okay, you can divide a set into two. It's a finite set or an infinite set. And infinite set can be classified into two, countably infinite, and uncountably infinite set. Or if you want, you can find it this way, countable set, uncountable set. And here, finite set, countably infinite set. The reason why I do make this classification is because it's very, very important. Okay? Some of you have taken the undergraduate optimization course where you learned or heard about integer programming. And your integer programming may have this kind of thing. So you want to find the x, or you want to find the vector x1 and x2. Here, your xi is an integer. Okay. The story becomes totally different when your entries in the decision parameter is from a countable set. See that? The set of integers have countably infinite numbers. Okay? But in this course, we are going to heavily utilize the result from calculus. What does that mean? We are going to make a differentiation. What does that mean? We need continuum. Okay? So we are not going to talk about the integer programming. Of course, this textbook has little bit of exposure to this one, when especially talking about linear programming. Because linear programming is a very special one. Okay? It can be efficiently solved for this uncountable case. And also it can be solved algorithmically, this countable case. Okay? But our focus is that omega is an uncountable set. Not only uncountable, but also our objective function is differentiable inside this constraint set. Okay. So we are going to rely on differentiation over multivariate function. Okay, got it? And this differentiation, this distinction between countable and uncountable is also very important when you do parameter estimation and detection. For example, in EECE 645, some of you have already taken, I teach detection and estimation. Who can tell me what was the major difference between these two problems, detection problems and estimation problems? We want to infer, make a statistical inference. In this case, also, in most of cases, a vector valued parameter. The difference is that in detection, we want to find whether it is from some finite or countable set. Okay? For example, we want to infer, make an inference about one bit. In that case, the bit is either 0 or 1, right? Only two choices are given, right? Or some quaternary symbol. In that case, among four, right? You have to choose the best guess. That is detection problem. But in estimation, it's like from some samples, we want to find the mean value. And that mean value can be any real number, right? In that case, our parameter to be decided is from an uncountably infinite set. Okay? And this distinction is very important, actually, because the techniques used to solve these problems are totally different. Let me give you a question, which was asked when I was a graduate student. So, in detection and estimation, which one is usually easier to solve? Or, otherwise, in other words, this optimization problem with finite choices called discrete optimization. And continuous optimization means your search space has uncountably infinite feasible or candidates? Usually, what do you guess? Which one is easy to solve? As an engineering sense. When I was you, I of course thought this is easier. It's like, okay, I have five choices. In my worst case, I just evaluate these five and compare the objective functions. No problem. I thought in that way. And some of you already have noticed. Usually, this is much easier, numerically and conceptually, because we can rely on the derivatives. Okay? This one, if the set size is small, it's okay. As I told you, suppose we have how many? 2 to the 11? It's okay now, right? 2 to the 11 choices, you just evaluate in 1 minute. your MATLAB can handle. That kind of many is okay. But in many cases, it's like you have what? A vector, the parameter of length, million sometimes. Now each entry can be 0 or 1, 2 to the million. Probably you can never graduate, okay, to exhaustively such. Okay? So this has so-called curse of dimensionality. When the length of the parameter to be found is small, then okay. But as the length goes large, then in many cases, our optimization problem has exponential complexity. So that it can easily become impossible problem to be solved numerically. Okay? So if you have taken some algorithms course from computer science, probably you heard about NP-hard and NP-complete type of classification of problems. Okay? And also, you were taught about the big O and little o notation related to the complexity of algorithm. Okay? Most of them are related to this problem, discrete optimization. And the curse of dimensionality is one of the most important things. Okay? So remember, if the number of choices is small, this problem is easy. You can just evaluate. However, if the size, length of the x to be optimized in our object optimization problem, if it becomes large, this is the problem hard to solve. Got it? Okay. So good thing is that in this course, we focus our attention to this continuous optimization. Of course, in some optimization problems, you have mixed optimization problems. Actually, the first serious engineering problem I myself confronted was this problem. And I had no idea about optimization, but I had to do my undergraduate thesis to do this. Okay, so the problem was like this. So I selected to write a software, a code that automatically designs an induction motor. Okay, I thought it's easy. If I want to have torque greater than something, consumption of power less than something, then I can easily find the parameters for the design. It's like diameter of the plate and thickness of the plate, something like that. Because diameter is what? A real number, right? It can be chosen from continuum. Thickness of a metal plate, well, I can choose, right? 0.3579 inches, okay. I believed in that way. But suddenly found that there is so-called Korean standard, KS. What does that mean? I cannot find arbitrary thickness of metal plate because no one produced that. Okay? So what I found is that many parameters I have to find were discrete. Some of them were continuous.
So it was kind of worst nightmare of an undergraduate student. I had no idea about optimization. The problem was mixed optimization problem. So my undergraduate thesis was very, very sloppy, okay, because I had no idea. So I developed a very strange optimization problem. Like, it's like, as I just told you, I separated the discrete parameters from continuous parameters. So it's like I have a very strange algorithm, definitely so suboptimal. So what I did was that I initially almost randomly choose discrete parameter values and then optimize continuous one. And then given that continuous one, I kind of iterative design without proving the optimality or convergence of that solution. So the professor was so disappointed in my thesis, so I barely graduated. That is my secret, okay? Anyway, so remember this, okay? In many engineering problems, it's actually mixed optimization problem. Some parameters you cannot choose arbitrarily. You have to choose from some finite or countable values, because your manufacturer does not generate that kind of arbitrary sized or thickness, plates, metal plates. Okay? If you want an arbitrary one, your cost becomes extremely large. For example, suppose our postcode generates the thick plate at every inch, but suddenly you want 1.79 inch thickness. You ask POSCO, probably they will cost you, they will charge you 100 times than the standardized one. Okay? Because they have to change everything, every process to generate. So even the thickness of wire is standardized, so you cannot arbitrarily choose. So remember, very practical optimization problem is highly likely to be a mixed optimization problem. Probably what you do is that you solve this one and approximate, okay? Because of kind of continuity belief, okay? If the objective function is a continuous function, then probably if you slightly change one parameter, the value will not change that much, okay? So finding the nearest quantized value may give you something okay, okay? But anyway, our focus here is this one. We are lucky in the sense that this nasty and nastier problems are not handled in this course. Okay, it seems I'm talking too much in our first meeting. So let me, but I have to mention another one. Another thing is this. I told you that we want to do some minimization of vector subject to x in the inner constraint set. Actually, this form, you may say that, it looks very general, but actually it is not. Okay. Here, this problem, this kind of problem is called single objective optimization. See that we have only one function f to be minimized, right? But this is not in many cases. For example, suppose we have data transmission over a channel. What do we want to do? What is good? Probably we want to maximize the transmission rate. So we want to choose transmission rate r and take negative sign and want to minimize this one, right? Which means maximization of transmission rate. But is this all? No. We want to, at the same time, minimize the bit error rate, right? We want to minimize bit error rate at the same time. Now we have two conflicting objectives. Both of them cannot be minimized at the same time. Usually, if we minimize the bit error rate, our transmission rate will be reduced, right? Because negative of r, okay? Well, what do we do?
One way is to have a kind of weighted sum, linearization. So we put some 5 of weight here, and 1 weight here, and sum, and put as an F. Or another one is that we put either one in the constraint. It's like bit error rate less than or equal to 10 to the minus 5. And then we minimize the negative of rate. But is that satisfactory? Sometimes that may be a good trade-off or compromise, but may not be what we want to do. Okay. So in some cases, we take both of them as our objective. In that case, it is called multiple or multi-objective optimization. So it's like this. Suppose we design a system A, and system A has bit error rate here and transmission rate here. So this is the operating point of system A. We design another system B. It has bit error rate here and transmission rate R here. Now let me ask you a question. Which one is better? Which one is a better system? It's not easy, right? If you have some system C here, then it has same BER but less transmission rate, so A is better, right? If you compare B and C, same transmission rate but smaller bit rate, C is better. But how can you compare A and B? But in multi-objective optimization problem, your objective is not to find a single solution. You want to find a collection of solutions so that, for example, am I right? Just a second, something is wrong. Yeah, not here, just a second. So given the BER, you want to maximize, so there should be bound. Something, yeah. Probably we have some boundary like this, okay? And yeah, this may be an achievable reason. So in this multi-objective optimization problem, we want to find optimal systems that are the fronts of this area, something like that. So there are many different optimization problems. Okay? Single objective optimization problems and multi-objective optimization problems. For example, if you have taken some economics course when you are an undergraduate student, probably you heard something similar like Pareto optimal solution, something like that. They are all talk about actually multi-objective optimization problems. This problem is not going to be handled. Okay? But slight exposure will be given you, because some of them appears in your estimation and detection theory. Okay? This course, since I'm teaching this course, will be closely related to our next course, estimation detection theory. Probably I will give you some homework or exam problems that is from that course. And actually, oh, you already taken TESOL. Okay? Not fair in that case. Anyway, he will get A+ anyway. So I will give you some problems from 6.5 where you will see multi-objective optimization and even some waveform design which can be reduced to vector optimization problems. Anyway, so this is our first meeting. What you have to remember is this. We are going to study single objective vector optimization problem in uncountably infinite set of constraint set. Got it? Okay. But there are many other important optimization problems. Again, let me emphasize that you have to buy the textbook. Okay? Read it carefully. Textbook is very well written, but it's difficult to read at the first time. Okay? You will use your textbook to solve homework problems. Okay? Okay, any questions? Okay, let's see then this Wednesday.